I'm Sam Pang, and this is ADBC. Tonight, our two teams will be tasting the treats from the food court of history and scooping from their Bay Marie of knowledge. Along the way, I'll be providing them with as much plastic cutlery as they need to slice through the two-for-one lunchtime special that is our past. Our first guest is a solicitor and an acclaimed author, Alice Pung. And our next guest has ascended to the throne of Australian comedy royalty after his predecessor mysteriously died under suspicious circumstances. Please welcome Tony Martin.
Thanks. Yes, Sam, all right, then I can confess at this point that I did kill Maury Fields. I did it with a double entendre. It's true. It's fatal.
On the BC team, our next guest studied at La Trobe and Melbourne Universities. She's a lecturer at the Australian Centre in the School of Historical Studies. Please welcome Faye Anderson.
Thank you.
And our final guest is one of the country's most versatile and talented performers. He has worked in film, theatre, television and radio. And tonight we've got him playing the very demanding role of Angus Sampson. Please make him welcome Angus Sampson. Angus, do you have a favourite person in history?
I quite like the host of Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous, Robin Leach. he was that sort of British expat that had gone to America, and do you remember?
Yes, I do.
He was kind of
the
like,
well, the rich and famous.
Yeah, the Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. He was like, well, it's caviar hellos and Dom Perignon goodbyes. La Dolce Vita doesn't get any sweeter.
Alice, what do you think has been the most amazing invention in history?
I got my first sewing machine from my parents when I was 12 because, you know, they probably wanted to train me up as a nice Southeast Asian outworker. So I make a... But anyhow, the most wonderful invention I can think of relates to the sewing machine. It's nylon, and it was invented by this dude in America and this other inventor in London. So it was invented in New York and London, and that's why it's called nylon.
Yeah. A combination of New York and London.
Yeah. I thought it was a funny name for a, you know, a fabric.
Not surely we get some points for that. That's 10, 15, surely.
Let's start the show. In this round, each team will be given the origins of a well-known phrase. They have to work out the modern phrase based on the information given. Team AD, you're up first for 10 points. Clue one. This term relates to a sign of approval and dates back to the Californian gold rush of the mid-19th century.
No, there's
next
nothing.
Next clue. No, straight under the next clue.
Nothing.
On the gold fields, prospectors and dealers would use this method to test whether a find was actually gold or just a base metal.
Panning for gold?
No.
No.
I think I'm going to give you another clue, but this is open to both teams.
Okay.
Back on the gold fields, however, if you poured some nitric acid onto a metal and it didn't bubble or fizz, it may have passed to Tony.
Is it fool's gold?
No,
that's
not
even. That's nothing to do with this, is it?
No.
It's just me grabbing a random phrase from the air and hoping that it's going to get me some
it's
points.
It's got gold in it. Back on the gold fields, if you poured some nitric acid onto a metal and it didn't bubble or fizz, it may have passed the
test.
The
test.
Acid test.
Well done. 10 points. The acid test. Fane Angus, here's your clues. Clue one. This British expression relating to outrageous expense is attributed to the reign of King William III.
Give us the second one.
Clue two. In 1696, the king caused a ruckus when he introduced the act of making good the deficiency of the clip money, which imposed a tax on the windows of homes.
He did, didn't he?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Essentially, this was a tax on glass, extremely unpopular because tenants were paying by the window.
This is where they had to board up their windows. The amount of windows you had, you would pay a tax because the assumption, I believe, was if you had many windows, you had many rooms. If you had many rooms, you had a large house. So people were boarding up their windows.
That is exactly right. So what were they doing? By boarding up windows, bricking up their houses, what were they doing?
Well, they something were breaking the law, and I'm quite upset about
throwing,
that. Don't encourage that.
No.
You were so close, but this clue is open to both teams.
I'm close. Oh, that's rare.
I've got to be fair, Faye. Angus is closer than you.
I told you it was rare.
Under the Act, the more windows in a building, the higher the tax. People began to brick up the walls of their homes, like Angus said, to avoid paying a tax on what was in effect natural light. So if you were taken to the cleaners in a monetary sense, you would have been exposed to...
Is it taken to the cleaners? Were you giving us that much of a clue?
No.
Sorry.
What was not coming in now that they'd bricked up their...
Light.
Yes. It was daylight.
Daylight robbery.
Well done, daylight robbery.
Can I just quickly jump in? Do you know the answers? Do you know the answers? Can I just confirm that?
Yeah, I do. I know the answers.
So I just would like to remind us that you are, in effect, misleading us with your inference and what have you.
Yes. I agree.
Really?
Yeah.
So if you could not do that...
Yeah. We might have more of a chance.
I would have thought that the amount of clues I gave there would have been enough. And eventually it was once I gave you both of the words. Alice and Tony, in that round, you didn't pick up any points, but Faye and Angus, you picked up 20 points. Well done.
Yeah, very long.
Next up is History Happened Here, where we present our teams with a postcard showing the location of a famous incident. The scene may look quite normal, but the event that happened here changed history. Both teams buzz in. If you think you know the answer, listen for your clues. Here's your postcard. Question is, where are we and what happened here?
Well, that's Old Parliament House.
Yes.
And it would be the first tent embassy.
That is exactly right. 10 points, Faye. Well done.
Well done.
How, is there a protocol on how we celebrate?
Tops off. What are you thinking?
Excuse me, no.
No, not you, Faye. Sorry.
Like every question we get right,
that would just disturb the audience at so many levels.
Well, you're exactly right. This is outside Old Parliament House in Canberra, where on the 26th of January 1972, Australian Aborigines established a tent embassy. Question two. Why were they protesting? Faye.
The Indigenous people and protesters decided, they found a loophole in the constitution that you could actually camp on the Commonwealth ground, and so they decided they'd put a camp as a protest about Indigenous rights and also land rights, and it still exists today.
Exactly right. Oh. 10 more points to Faye and Angus. Well done. Term tent embassy, why is this considered particularly pointed?
Do you mean pointed as in architecturally, the embassy?
Alice.
This is just a guess. An embassy is a representation of a nation, isn't it? So if you have an Aboriginal tent embassy, it means that in Canberra they have a representation of the Indigenous people, a very clear and obvious one as well.
That's right, making a statement that they consider themselves strangers in their own land. Exactly,
yes.
Right, Alice. I'm going to give you 10 points for that. Well done.
Oh.
Wow, what an amazing Prime Minister. He could fly. In that round, Alice and Tony, you picked up 10 points. Faye and Angus, you picked up 30 points. Well done. We'll be back after this.
Tonight we've got an actual Stone Age recipe. This dish was probably the first ever concocted over fire. The main ingredient, the stinging nettle. Scourge of gardeners everywhere. Let's see if we can get it in them.
Welcome back to ADBC. We're currently, Alice and Tony are on 10 points. Faye and Angus are on 50 points.
Is that Benicio del Toro?
In What's My Scene, a classical painting is presented to the panellists. Their challenge, should they choose to accept it, is to identify what is taking place and discuss its significance. For 10 points, what is happening in this picture? What can we see here?
It appears to be someone in a turban just clearly against the laws of science, just appearing in the middle of the ocean in a bubble. Everyone's going, hang on, that can't be right. Come and have a look at this. I can't imagine that that's the answer, though.
Someone is being submerged into a diving bell. When I say a diving bell, a glass tub. This scene was painted in the 16th century. So for 10 points, which great conqueror of the ancient world is going for a plunge? Angus.
Potentially, is that Alexander the Great?
That is exactly right. That is who it is. Well done. 10 points. In terms of technology, did the ancient Greeks have the ability to walk on the ocean floor? Alice.
Alexander the Great was Macedonian, and he's being submerged in a bubble there. I remembered he almost conquered the known world at that time, and he was a bit of a megalomaniac. So maybe this is a far-off guess. He was trying to conquer sea space. He'd done land space, and he was probably moving on to airspace.
No, that's exactly right. Well done. 10 points.
And here's something I know about Alexander the Great. Isn't it true that he was buried in a glass coffin that was filled with honey? Is that meant to be true?
That was his Bucks night.
See?
Yes, because honey is the only natural substance that doesn't go off. I think they found it in tombs, and they were meant to preserve him because he was this great hero. And he did die at 32, so maybe it was a Bucks night.
Another thing about when he conquered Persia, apparently he introduced the habit of kissing people on the hand, which was frowned upon by the Greeks. No problem with sodomy, apparently, but kissing on the hand right out of the line. It's true.
Alice and Tony, in that round you picked up 10 points, and Faye and Angus, you also picked up 10 points. Well done. A historic meal has been prepared by Friendy in accordance with an actual recipe of the time. Friendy, what's our dish tonight?
Tonight, we've got a savoury type pudding with a very prickly main ingredient.
Have a taste and a poke and a smell, but more importantly, I need you to tell me what is the key ingredient.
Oh.
Angus, you've had a taste. What's it? How's it?
Does it have parents?
Is that spinach? It's actually
it has...
good.
It's good.
Friendy, am I asking Friendy? Friendux, does that have that's meat in there?
The stock has meat, but the main ingredient is plant-based.
Oh, it's a plant.
So we're trying to guess this, green thing.
The main ingredient. The main ingredient.
Is it grass? It tastes like grass.
It's kind of, you know, it's weedy.
It's lucerne hay. It's what? Did you say it's weed? It's weed?
Yeah, it is.
It's marijuana?
Angus has had quite a lot of that.
Yes.
He really has. He's had half of it.
Well, just make sure.
The main.
Oh, this no, is, Angus, it's really?
Australian actor, you don't get to eat much.
That's not eat.
Ooh. Alice, have you had a taste?
Yes, I've had
I'll
lots
let
of it.
Angus chew.
Would you describe it as good shit?
It's good.
What's the main ingredient? It's not grass.
It's not grass. Oh, it's that thing that looks like grass.
It's lucerne.
AstroTurf.
No. It's a prickly plant. It begins with N.
N. Is it Madison's
first? Nettle, stinging nettle.
It is nettle. That's it. Well done.
Nettles.
How many nettles have you eaten?
You've been eating nettles.
I still can't believe Alice Fung went straight to marijuana.
You said weed.
Yeah, you did, actually.
It wasn't an offer.
Other ingredients in the mix are dandelion, sorrel, watercress, barley flour and chives. Friendy has put in some effort.
Yeah.
Now...
Thanks, Friendy.
Question two. The country of origin and the era.
I'd go era rather than country of origin. It's a long time ago. Because I actually...
Yes, well done. 10 points.
I don't think anyone recently would eat that, really.
This is actually one of the oldest recipes known to humankind. And it dates... Stone Age?
Wow.
Think about countries that you associate good food with and then rule them out.
Oh, crap.
The UK. I think everyone's jumped for England or Scotland.
Wow, that wasn't even a clue, really, was it? That is right. It's from Britain and it's around 6,000 years old, this recipe.
Yeah, and it tastes like that as well.
What is it called, Sam?
This is called nettle pudding.
Sam, may I ask Friendly a question?
Absolutely.
Friendly, how was the recipe recorded? Like, how was that handed down?
On a stone. It was the Stone Age.
Question three.
I reckon Freddie just hadn't organised anything. They're like, what do you got tonight, Freddie? Trust me, they wrote it on the stone.
Britain, 6,000 years old, from the Stone Age, nettle pudding. What does the dish tell us about the development of the cuisine and cooking, and indeed the people who cooked it? Alice?
Maybe they weren't that healthy. They didn't have modern dentistry, which is why everything is ground up and rolled into a ball and boiled for hours.
A tradition that remains to this day.
You're asking why did
Being
they cook it?
Yeah, why? No, I'm asking that. Why do you think they cooked it?
They evolved?
Mm.
Yes, they were trying to improve the taste of the dish. This dish could be eaten raw, but they decided to cook it
in their cuisine. Don't they have cows?
Don't they have cows?
Well, wouldn't you go for something that's like meat rather than nettles?
Friendy will answer that question.
That wasn't on the stone.
Nettles are highly nutritious, and there's meat is actually cooked in the stock, so you still eat the meat as well.
What sort of meat, Friendly?
In this one particular, it's pork.
Nice. Did they have pigs or just dinosaurs in those
days? I wasn't there.
Friendy, I'm just slowly losing control of the show over here.
I'm not supposed to talk. I've gone way over my word limit.
Sorry,
Friendy. As I said, this is an indication that Stone Age people were not eating merely to survive, that they obviously considered taste important.
Culinary evolution.
That is right.
So when did the people of Britain decide to throw that idea away?
Alice and Tony, in that round you picked up 10 points. Faye and Angus, you picked up 20 points. Well done. And we should all thank Friendy. Thank you very much, our chef extraordinaire. This is ADBC. We'll be back after the break. Welcome back to ADBC. Let's do a quick score check. Alice and Tony, you're currently on 30 points. Faye and Angus, you're on 80 points. Well done.
Benicio del Toro.
Our teams will be shown a shot of a banknote from a particular country. This is about the money. Their job is to look at the artwork and the symbols on the notes. So, what note are we shining the spotlight on tonight? Faye.
The ruble.
Yes, 10 points. It's the ruble from Russia and it's 1947. Question two. On the front side of the note, we can see the famous communist hammer and sickle. For a further 10 points, what do they symbolise individually and in combination? Faye.
The hammer would be representing the worker, industrial workers.
Yes.
And the sickle would represent the agricultural worker, the peasant.
Yes. Combined, Faye and Angus, what do they represent? What do they symbolise?
Unity.
That is exactly right. Well done to both of you. 10 points. Question three, obviously it's Lennon on the front.
Oh, it's not hypnotist Martin St. James. Got that wrong, sorry.
He's sort of good looking though, isn't he?
The hypnotist Martin St. James or Lennon?
Lennon. It's a good photo.
For 10 points, complete the missing word in this famous quote about money, and I'm paraphrasing, the best way to destroy the capitalist system is to do what to the currency? Alice.
Destroy.
Debauch.
Debauch?
Yes.
Oh. So he's asking people to have sex with the money.
Debauch can mean many things, but one is reduce the quality time.
Oh.
Which, if you had sex with it, that would probably reduce it as well.
Hello. Oh. Steady.
When did Lennon's likeness come off the 10 ruble note?
I think it was in 1984 when they replaced him with Nikolai Volkov.
the great Russian wrestler.
And partner to the Iron Sheik.
The image of Lennon was taken off in 1992.
And who's on there now, Sam?
Nikolai Volkov. Nikolai Volkov is on there now, yeah. Angus. Yeah. The end of that round. Alice and Tony, you didn't pick up any points, but Faye and Angus, you picked up 20 points. Well done. This is our fast buzz-in round. Teams will put their brains on their shoulders and the brains on their desks to the test. They will buzz in and tell me which statement is fact or fiction. Question one. Continuing the ancient tradition, women were excluded from competing in the first modern Olympics in Athens in 1896. Alice.
I would say that would be true.
That is a fact. Women were allowed to compete in the next Olympics, but it was not until 1928 they were allowed to run the 800 metre track event.
But she didn't fulfil the requirements of the program.
She did by saying it was true, and true meaning fact meant that she had answered the question.
It doesn't say true or fiction.
Oh, whoops.
This fast buzz around could last 3 hours. Here we go. Question two. Attila the Hun's seemingly inevitable conquest of Europe was only halted by his assassination by Roman spies. Fact or fiction? Alice, Tony.
Wrong. That's fiction.
That is fiction. Well
done, sir. Of course it is. Of course it is.
Whilst in a drunken stupor on his wedding night, he choked to death from a nosebleed.
Given to him by Nikolai Volkov.
It all comes back to wrestling. Question three. The longest-serving member of the Australian Parliament has been William Morris Hughes, who served 51 years from 1901 to his death in 1952. Fact or fiction? Angus.
I used to live in the house that was built for him in Sydney, and he didn't move in there, and his brother did, and it had rising damp.
Is that true?
Fact.
Fact is right. Question four. In Britain's worst modern natural disaster, it's estimated that 23,000 were killed as a result of the 1783 eruption of Iceland's Laki volcano. Tony.
I actually moved into that volcano back in the early 1970s, and that is fact.
That is a fact. Well
there
done.
You go. Thank you very much.
From its toxic gases, a fifth of Iceland's population was also killed. Question five. For hundreds of years, from the 12th century, Egyptian mummies were taken to Europe, ground down into a powder and used as medicine. Alice.
I would guess that that was true because I read somewhere they were also used for makeup.
That is a fact. From the mistaken belief that mummies were wrapped with a bitumen called mummia with healing qualities. That is exactly right. Well done.
That is true, but again, no points.
Question six. Walt Disney was among the first people to be cryogenically frozen.
Fiction. That's complete nonsense.
That is right.
Never happened.
Never happened. He was actually cremated 2 days after his death.
And he wasn't a very nice man.
Well, whoa. For all the Disney...
Faye, tell us more.
He spied on people, cartoonists, that he thought were suspect, and he gave the information to Hoover. He was also very anti-Semitic.
Absolutely.
He wasn't a very pleasant man.
Well, Faye, you'll be happy to know he was cremated 2 days after his death and then frozen to seal in the flavour. Question seven. In 1940, Japan dropped bubonic plague-infested fleas on China, causing epidemic plague outbreaks.
Oh, I don't want to cast aspersions on the Japanese, so I would say false.
It is fact.
Oh.
See, I did want to cast aspersions on the Japanese, so if you'd let me answer that, we would have done fine.
Final question. Mount Everest should be pronounced Everest, as it was named after Sir George Everest, who pronounced his name Everest. Alice.
That sounds about true.
That is about a fact. Yes, well done. He didn't want the mountain named after him, but Nikolai Volkov wanted it named after him, so that's where it all goes. That's the end of the show. Alice and Tony, you finished on 90 points, but tonight's winners, the BC team of Faye and Angus, on 110 points. Well done. We'd like to thank Alice Pung and Tony Martin. And also Faye Anderson and Angus Sampson. Thanks for watching ADBC, and remember, those who do not learn from history are condemned to repeat it. With that in mind, we'll be back next week to do it all over again. My name was Sam Pang. Good night. Rush, rush,
you couldn't just give us a piece of pizza either. You, you had to give us a bug omelet,
a
man.
Silky.
because my husband's obsessed with World War II, so he would really dig me, and also I do look stunning in black and white.
Wait. You're saying you would go back to World War II because your husband would be obsessed with you?
Yeah.
The man you already married to?
Yeah.